really how I look at it. And this is the VJ, the role of the VJ. Now, I use the VJ instead of PowerPoint. I just say PowerPoint is a Gutenberg person, is a Google person using Gutenberg meeting or a Gutenberg person. But PowerPoint is all about your control. It's about you projecting up on the screen. What's most important are the points, the powers in the point. Friends, don't let friends use PowerPoint. So this is an alternative to PowerPoint. I do this when I'm teaching. My teaching assistant is my teacher. And that's how I use a teaching assistant. Now where I got this idea is I noticed very early on, a long time ago, that my students, I'm looking at the back of their screens, and I'm realizing that everything they do, everything I say is being Googled. Nothing I'm saying, they're not Googled. In fact, that's the kind of note taking of this. They're putting it up on Twitter or Googling it or another thing. But they're testing everything I say. Really what he's talking about, or they're bringing up in the image form so they can see it all the time. So I had the idea, why don't we, as I'm preaching, why don't we do the same thing? So everything that I say is brought up in image form real time. You have your live with you. So and you need, not what's here, which is where you can show YouTube's, because unless you've downloaded ahead of time, it's such a slow connection. You need a good. And I'd like you to say, let me start with this. The internet now is a utility. And everybody else seems to get this, but the church. It's a utility. I don't go to a hotel and say, how much extra is the water? You know, I expect water. I don't say, how much extra is the electricity? I expect electricity. I hate it. When I go and say, how much extra is the internet? That's why, and actually, I will stay at a Hampton Inn more than a Marriott, Hilton sometimes, because Hampton Inns have free internet. It is a utility. And you can't use social media in worship or without good internet connections. And this is how important it is for me. Can you imagine the last 500 years doing ministry and saying, I'm sorry, but I don't do books? Can you imagine doing ministry the next 20 years saying, I'm sorry, I don't do social media? Sing. There is a new delivery system for information. And it is no longer. Media is not a zero-sum game, so I'm writing more books than ever. People are buying more books than everybody, and then everybody who's on the internet now is a bookseller. That's why these big things go on because everybody, I mean, thanks to Amazon, everybody now has a franchise. You get a kickback, you get order for your site. Everybody's selling books. We don't lose, when you have a new media form, you don't lose the old. How's your paperless office? We're drowning in paper. So, and one of the best investments you can make is in paper. So, no. But, the new delivery system for this TGIF culture is what we're talking about today, and it's not. For us to think that we can do ministry, I mean, it's not bad. I teach at a school. I mean, I'm a provider. I require my students to have, as part of their educational experience, they have to either do Twitter or Facebook, and they have to, we do peer-to-peer things on it. And I had a whole group of students, this is 2 years ago, who said, we do not want to go on social media. We've never been on it. We don't want to apply. We don't think we should have to apply. I said, are you taking this course? It's a required course. Methodist Church. And they said, no, I went and protested to the dean. And had a big, huge protest. The Swede is making us use social media. And so we finally reached a resolution that they could go to another seminary and take the course. Because they were so adamant that they did not want it. And you're going to go to ministry. You wonder why churches are dying? So, this is ridiculous. So we've got to find a way to bring this into the orbit of what we're doing. And one of the ways in which, we'll talk about some of the different ways, but one of the most important ways is, for me, the use of this DJ, this video chat. Who's my equivalent of our own? I call this person my dancing partner because, remember what Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, remember there, some of you know him. I need to give you a witness if anybody does. It's okay. But remember what they said about Ginger Rogers? She did everything he did, except backwards in high heels and with a flowing dress. So actually, if you have a good VJ, they are working harder than you. Because they are doing everything that you're doing, except they don't know what you're going to do. And they're doing it backwards. In high heels with this technology and in this big, you know, big focus. So you celebrate your DJ, and that's why I like my DJ to be up front, that people see this person and not be hidden, but for them to see the ministry. Let me also say that we are losing generations because we're not calling out our ministries. And this is a ministry for which we need to call. In fact, we are not. These are those. I am here today, and I would not be here today, I don't think. If I did not receive a call at 13 years of age from my pastor, he had never spoken to me before in any serious way. It was just high land. Lightning, they call it that, don't you all hear that? But it was a Friday night, I was 13, about ready to go out, and his name is Dr. Leonard Snow. Dr. Leonard Snow called me on the phone, and my mother answered it, and somebody had no idea what that was, but we actually had rotary. But I said something. Said that their kid went by with something, and they had no idea what it was. And he said, what's a telephone booth? He said, telephone booth, what's a telephone booth? And they had explained to their kid what a telephone booth was. And I said, why would you need a booth to make a telephone booth? So, everybody here knows a telephone booth, but your kids. So it was, my mother asked the phone, handed me the phone, and said, Dr. Snow wants to speak to you. This was not immediately good news to me. But immediately I got thinking. And the church that I grew up in at this point, almost 2,000 members, dynamic, big youth group, big choir, in the Bible, the choir in the front, everybody saw them. Just up in upstate New York. It was like Southern Choir. By the way, it closed 10 years ago, so I'm apostles. My life. In fact, in my hometown, all three Methodist churches, my hometown, have closed. All three of them. I got some Methodists here. Tribes. By the way, Southern Baptists are in front of my life. That's a good one. You just just hide your statistics better. That's all I'm going to say. But this is 13. And I get on the phone, and I immediately start thinking, we also had this wonderful church, had a steeple, and a lot of us teenagers had interesting things as well. He found that. So he goes, Leonard, and this time he didn't call me Lenny, so I knew I was in real trouble. And he said, yes, Dr. Snow. He said, how are you? I said, I'm fine. I'm all ready to go out. He said, well, before you go out, I'm going to talk to you. And I said, okay. And I started to say something about the steeple, like, I'm sorry, or something, but I checked myself. I was glad I did, because he said, Leonard, your church is music. He said, I'm calling you because your church needs you and I need you. I said, I don't know what you mean. And he said, you know Miss Downs? Miss Downs is already inspired. I said, yes. He said, well, she alone. And I said, well, that is great. He said, yeah, it's great for her, but it's not great for the church. And I said, well, how much have you done? He said, oh, she alone. I understand eloping. He said, no, she's gone. She's left town. She's gone. She's alone. She's now living with her husband. And they're in a whole other state. And I'm still not computing this. And then he says, but I found a choir director for Sunday. But I haven't found an organist. And I said, well, do you want me to help you find one? Or yeah. And he said, I want you to be our organist. I said, Dr. Snow, I've never played the organ in my life. He said, yes, but you play the piano. I said, Dr. Snow, the piano organs are very different, isn't it? And he said, I know, but we need you. Your church needs you. I need you. I said, Dr. Snow, I have never touched one. I said, besides, the church organ has four keyboards. I've only ever dealt with one. He said, forget three of them. Just pretend you're not there. I said, Dr. Snow, there's these things on the floor called pedals. He said, pretend you're not there. I said, Dr. Snow, I would not have known to turn it on. You have these knobs that come out. And I would, it was a bolt tracker. I would not know. I would know how to do it. He said, I'll show you. And I will meet you at the church in an hour, and I'll unlock it for you. Show you. I'll unlock it. I'll give you the key, and I'll show you a little bit of the knobs that I know of to turn it on. And I could not say no to Dr. Snow. Now, the reason why, so I became a church organist at 13, of 2003. And it was all those organs. You had the Bible Belt choir here, but then you had the organ with the in the middle. So that it was right behind the pastor, so all you saw was the back of the organist, and he's huge. At 13. And so you know what I did for Friday night? You know what I did all day Saturday? Now the reason why I say I would not be here today without that call is that at 17, I deconverted. I was brought up as a long, you're going to go through it, but it was a very, it's a Pentecostal holiness. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And it was as close to Amish as you could get. In fact, some of the women actually wore the coffee filters. The women showed them the skin. It was conservative, as fundamentals. I discovered liberty from you Baptists. I discovered freedom from the Baptists, okay, at summer camp. That's how conservative this was. And at 17, it's a long story, but I said, I need to be converted. I became a raging atheist. Some people so well those I planted a prayer. For six, almost 7 years, the only thing that kept me trapped during that 7 years outside, not believing that God existed, and if God did exist, I said, I hate you, God. The only thing that kept me trapped was love. How did I needed to make money. And how did I make money? I played poker. And I could not escape every Sunday. Worship. I could not escape. Even in the midst of my rage, I could not escape preaching. I could not escape the music. And if I had not had that, it could keep me in the conversation. I'm not sure if you're here today. You got 13-year-olds, you need to call the phone and say, your church needs you. That's not the flavor, or it may not be. But it's to do precisely the social media stuff. It's to be your vision. It's to show how you can use social media for the glory of God and worship in the church. And the fact that we're not calling on is saying the church needs you. With untold consequences. So this is very dear to me, because I'm here today because somebody called me out at 13. We do call out. This is an area where we sit at the feet of our children. Anybody want to argue with me? I mean, you had kids to work the fields, and I had kids to work the electronics. This is their native language. They speak it fluently. It's about time we let them meet us. So this VJ then becomes my dancing partner. And this is one use of social media. Is as I'm, as I said this morning, there are many right ways of worship. My preferred way, and sometimes I don't, but is with three screens. One screen is that live internet feed that my VJ is constantly throwing images or YouTubes. Depending on how the Spirit moves and depending on the interaction with the congregation, we look at different things. But if I am talking about, for example, if I'm talking about Martin Luther King Jr., an image of Martin Luther King Jr., if I'm talking about Martin Luther, there's an image of Martin Luther. If I'm talking about my church, Gloversville, United Methodist Church, you would be seeing Gloversville Methodist Church. So there is a visual component for it. And you can play these little YouTubes, which make a huge amount of noise. On another screen, besides the media, and part of this thing is, and this is where you want to get a kid, not somebody who's older. Because the older people want to know ahead of time exactly what are you going to say so I can go to the sites ahead of time so I can prepare. And I'm saying no. These kids don't have any of that. Because they see, for us it's trial and error. For them it's trial and success. They aren't afraid of making mistakes. Because that's what it is to be on the internet, is to go to the wrong sites and you gotta start over and go to another one. So it's trial and success. For us is, you don't do it until you get it right. You can't make a mistake because it's just Google. The other screen is, and there are devices that will let you throw up on screen text messages, Twitter, all sorts of inputs that can be put together on one, that come together, multiple streams can be put together. So I have a live Twitter feed. And this is where I encourage, especially if we get a hashtag for your service, kind of summarize the major narrative for that service, and encourage those present to respond, to take notes, and to be in, just to tell the truth. If you're not getting something, put it up there. If you are getting something, put it up there. But to have it in real time. So there is a live thing. And then thirdly is the screen, because I'm usually out of the congregation, not up front, but out in this congregation, they still need an image of you and them together. So there's that third. They still need that that sentiment of the preacher who's interacting with them. So that, but again, there's no one right way. That's just my preferred way of doing it. And I have done it. I did a Korea in a stadium with another whole different language, working through an interpreter with 30,000 people. And I've done it with 30. So you can, it works, it can be meaningful for a lot of different But I think the key thing, regardless of what you do with the other, is the key thing is the use of this DJ. And to begin to bring into visual form our, what we're saying. I think we all have to learn to speak more visually, to speak more metaphorically, but it also helps to make those metaphors come alive visually. And that's the whole of the people. If we're going for any comments, questions, responses, nervousness. Here's how I do that with preachers, but I speak a lot of preachers, conventions, and stuff. I'm right now in the fifth. I'm in my fifth preaching style. The notion that you can get through your entire life with one preaching style. Notion that you're going to end up your ministry preaching the same way you started your ministry with? When the world has changed so quick and so fast, we are called the big fresh bread, sister and brother. Fresh bread. And you keep the bread fresh. Nobody's expecting to go through life at one time. So why do we think we're so different that we can freeze and preaching style and track it through our entire life. It's constant learning, unlearning, relearning, learning, unlearning, relearning. So, and it's not about me anyway, it's about how do you live a Christ with the Lord. So.
I don't know.
King Jr.
They're on.
I mean, they, as soon as you, all the words out of your mouth. They're, they, yeah.
Because they're not giving certain points or scriptures.
Images. And see, that's the difference. They're not on Google word search, they're on Google image search. See, we all, we're using, we're searching words. They're doing Google image search. Yeah. But there are some concerns here. That is, do you have a filter or do you not?
Yes.
And I started doing this. And I'm the first one to preach to you on stuff like this. I was adamant that you don't use a filter because it needs to be real and authentic. So I've had some experiences that have changed that a little. So.
And you got that from the church.
Yes. Yeah. And then people think that you actually did that on purpose. No, and for some reason, I don't know why this is the case, but some disciples of Jesus are some of the most easily offended people. And instead of everybody covering each other's back, they finding good things to find fault with. So, unfortunately, this is the world of the church, and so we just have to deal with it. But, yeah. But so I think there is, and you, they're real easy, you know, and it gives you a little split second to decide do I show this up there or not. And just in that little microsecond, you can make a little decision. Maybe I don't know.
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, the question is, do I give them any advanced clues? But what if I know I'm going to use, and sometimes, you know, if I know I'm going to use a YouTube, usually I try and use at least one YouTube per version. I will let them know ahead of time so that can be really quick. But sometimes I will just think on YouTube. I'll say, you know, why don't you go check this out? Do mock visualization. This is, we talked about how classical music is 25% of all music purchased when I was born was classical. Yeah, but it's kind of you to be my order. All right. And it's not 2%. So it's not in my lifetime from 25% to 2%. People are trying to find ways. Because, yeah, we got the commercials because, look how many hits. Here, just play it, even though we got it. It's going to be hard to take. But this is how, this is the only, you want to get kids to listen to classical music, here's how you got to do it. Somebody up there snoring.
Oh.
think that will diminish our role and authority. Actually, it actually enhances it. Because it shows you that I don't have an ego that's the best on my sleeve. That I can handle, that I'm actually, what I'm actually into is you, not me. Not me looking good. But I'm interested in lifting up Christ. If I'm not doing it well enough, or if I'm getting a little slow and sluggish about it, this is all about it. It makes me authentic, transparent. So it's a whole different, it's a very different paradigm from a performance mode to participation mode. It's all about the quality of the participation and the quality of the performance.
So you can get the same sermon, several times with a DJ and a totally different sermon.
Yes. And because, partly because your sermon is being shaped by the interactions taking place with. You have an idea where you want to go. Here's one little story. I was a guest. This is one pastor came in and showed his congregation how this would work. And again, I knew nobody in this church except the pastor. It's not your guest preacher. But I choose my text. I love this text where Paul talks about how each one of us is to be the aroma of Christ. The ode to Jesus. I grew up singing a song called Deep and Wide. And there was a certain way of singing it where you just skipped a and why, and why. And that's all we're singing. Every time pastors gather together, anyway, I don't know if you're musicians, but you've got similar questions. How's your church? Well, we lost 20 people last year. Or we baptized 100 more years before. Or my budget is really hurt. Or we have $6 million. Start singing deep and low. We're all doing well. We're doing my church, not the church. So I'm trying to. So I'm at the middle of the congregation. I got a DJ. And we got this text, so I'm trying to get the air for it. Right? I said, so tell me, Paul says that we're all supposed to smell like Jesus. So the big question comes, what does Jesus smell like? So what do you think Jesus smells like? Right. So somebody in the congregation said it. First thing out of their mouth, rose of sugar. Okay? So I say, rose of sugar. That's so biblical, you're so right. And that was my DJ. Yeah. And I'm looking up there and I'm going, wait a minute, that's not a rose. We're going to have rose of sugar. And they're going, well, that is a rose of Sharon. I'm going, is that a rose? That's a rose of Sharon. I mean, that. So now everybody's looking at me like, what kind of a doofus is this guy? Because I'm looking for the roses. I'm going, you know, roses, they never smell to me. Anybody, you know, they're so hybridized and inbred on their smell. They go, well, these are smell. So now I'm in a learning mode with congregation, you get it? So I got gardeners there that are teaching me. So I'm saying, Because they now like what they're teaching me. And I'm learning something with them. Right? So I'm like, okay, well, what else does Jesus smell like? So somebody immediately goes,
lily of the valley.
So I go, lilies. I say, God, my lilies are so, they talk about that from going nothing, no smells to something that really is super sweet and sticky smell. I said, I just don't like lilies because they remind me of funerals. And I go, wait a minute, give me a lily of that. And I think, well, that doesn't look like a lily. Are you sure? I said, then they all laugh again. So that's a real lily. Do they smell? And so this, well, not as much as one of those trumpet movies. And so I'm with me. So we're going, I know where I want the sermon to go, but we're still interacting. So they bread, he smelled like fresh loaf of bread, pecan pie, and stuff. So so we're going a little bit, and I'm going, okay. So I know where I think I want the sermon to go. So there. Okay, now. Let me ask you something. You give me all these wonderful, beautiful smells. And then Jesus is supposed to smell them right away. It's like all these wonderful smells. But do you think Jesus always smells good? Because, okay. Where do I want to lead them? If you are where Jesus is, does Jesus always just go where it's smelled? In fact, Jesus is never at the center of anything. He's always at the edges. He's always on the periphery where it don't smell so good. In fact, who did Jesus hang out with? People who didn't smell so good. So that's why I want the sermon to go. So actually, you may know that you're giving off the Jesus odor more, not just if you smell so nice and sweet, but maybe we need to be smelling some ugly odors if we're going to be where Jesus says. That's why I want the sermon to go. God, I don't know. So I go. So Jesus always has to smell good. We got real quiet. I find someone waiting there and said, you know what? I never thought of it, but I think Jesus smells like Sarah. Those of you here this morning. Exactly. Because I have no idea. Forgot who Sarah is. She's just made fun of a homeless person. See what I mean? I'm only part of that. So I have no idea. But this is a hot wire man. But when you ever don't know what to say, you say what? Say, because I knew the word next word out of my mouth, but so same. So the person actually stood up. I said, I never thought of it like this, but we have a Jesus smell in our church, and it's Sarah. Whenever I'm around Sarah, this odor of Jesus is so strong in her. She's our Jesus smell. I never thought of it like that. Yeah, I don't know who this is. I have no idea what she's talking about. But my VJ is from the church. So next thing I know, he's got a picture of this older woman up on the screen. And I'm trying to, I still don't know what's going on. But I'm noticing over here, about where you are, but a little further above, there's this woman on the red. And she has about the same color hair. I can't see her face because her head's down. But the woman in the back, she sits down. And suddenly, somebody over here says, you know, I never thought of it. You were so right. You know what Sarah did for me last week? The next 10, 15 minutes, they were popping up all over that place, giving Sarah testimonies as to how she is the smell of Jesus for the church. Sarah's over here now. She's starting to cry. And the whole congregation just bathed her in love. Took the sermon away from me. And I realized I was a straight person there. You know what? Because God wanted Sarah to know how much my heart was wrong. And I'm so proud that they took that sermon from me. And Sarah came up to me after and said, I have no idea. It's congregation. It's not that easy for me. I have no idea. It's just congregation care. I can't believe this has never happened before I've seen it. So you've got to trust the Spirit. So I got this Holy Spirit thing. Exercise those muscles. Holy Spirit. So, you see, See what I'm talking about? Now, we've all got it. You've got to start getting used to using social media. And go to my Twitter. I put on my Twitter here. This is my I at first refused to do Twitter. I was proud of it. But I was not going to use this kind of social media. And
I got called out actually by the head, by his name is Aaron Linnae, and I just
dedicated my book viral. I put on social media to him, this came out this year. He's head of online media for Lifeway. And he posted a tweet of the 10 people that should be on Twitter. And I was one of the 10. And so I proudly, emailed him back and said, somebody said that you've been called out by Aaron, and you need to get back to him. And so I said, okay. And so I emailed back and I said, you called me out. That just, this is ridiculous. I have no interest in telling people I have to know. And that's what Twitter is that used for, basically. It's just, who did you see? Would you have to lunch? But here's what he did. He gave me an arrow for me. And it changed my life. So now, I am actually on Twitter. And I only follow my students, I don't follow many people, but and I only follow my students that are continuing to be on Twitter. Some of them just drop off, but I don't follow them. But those are all the people that I follow, see the people in the background. So those are all my students that, provide an image of those people that I'm following. I hate somebody to get all their images and put them together as But here's what he said to me. He said, Leonard, you're a historian. In the medieval world, there were such things as village commons. The village square. He said, in the course of the day, everybody in that village would pass one another in the village square. And they would exchange pleasantries. They would say, how's your day going? What'd you eat? You doing okay? Did you see so-and-so? He said, Twitter's every village square. It's the new global commons. And this is where people are crossing and passing exchanges and finding out how they're doing. And I could not escape his narrative. And I realized he's right. But if I'm going to be in Twitter, I'm not going to be of Twitter. So the question is not for me, what are you doing? Which is, what's the saying now about the question of says tweets. We used to say, what are you doing before you? For me, if I'm going to be in Twitter, I'm not going to tell what I'm doing. I want to share what I see God doing. So I just reoriented that question from what are you doing to what is God? And so I tweet things about what I see God doing, some of the issues of culture, little sayings, things that I come up with that point to Christ. There's a ways in which it's not about me, even where I am. It's about what is God doing, what do I think the Spirit is up to, and how I can provoke people to conversation. So this is my Twitter feed, and I have quite a few subscribers. The issue is also how many of them will take the conversation and run with it and make it their own. And that's really what the influence is do they take these little tweets? And much of what Jesus said can be put in tweet form. I mean, basically, the Beatitudes are just a series of tweets. that's a Twitter feed. And I will probably post 4 or 5 things a day. Just thoughts, quotes. And a lot of times what I do is when I'm reading a book, I will tweet my notes. So instead of putting my notes on paper, I just share them with everybody. So the quotes, the thesis, some interesting stuff. I was reading a book on the criminalization of American culture. I came up with the fact that there now, a few years ago, there was just a handful of federal laws, criminal laws. There are now 40,000 federal criminal laws. 40,000. Basically, every day you're breaking the law, doing something. Nobody's just enforcing the law, but they've had so many laws on those laws. And then you've got local and state laws increasing. So, almost every second, I'm breaking some law. So, just provocative stuff. Now, look at my Facebook page. I have a Facebook, and I don't have a fan page because I hate that language. So what I've done is I've made my personal page public. So basically anybody can post on it. They max out at 5,000. So you can only have 5,000, but then you can make it public. So I open it up to the public. And I get all sorts of people. And unless it's vulgar, I let us in. Even critiques of me. And I want to show you, I posted this here, I put it here. This is my favorite passage from Kathleen Norris's Amazing Grace. 2 paragraphs I read periodically when I get discouraged about the church. And let me just read this for you. From the outside, true congregations who look remarkably like contentious places, full of hypocrites who talk about love while fighting each other tooth and nail. This is the reason many people do for avoiding them. On the inside, however, it's a different matter. A matter of struggling to maintain unity as the body of Christ, given the fact we have precious little uniformity. I've only to look at the congregation of best that I belong to. We are not individuals who have come together because we are like-minded. That is not a church, but a political partner. We are, like most healthy churches, I think, in that we can do pretty well when it comes to loving and serving God, each other in the world, but God help us if we have to agree about it. I contest our uniformity by suggesting a major remodeling of the sanctuary, or worse, the Holy of Holies, the church kitchen. But I value my life too much. The church is like the incarnation itself, a shaky proposition. It is a human institution full of ordinary people, sinners like me, who do and say cruel things. But it is also a divinely inspired institution full of good purpose, which partakes of a unity far greater than the sum of its parts. That's why it's called the body of Christ. All right, thanks a lot. I don't care whether you got a house church or you got a mega church, this is, you got to deal with this, right? So, 100 people, 37 people share it, 100 people, they say you get about 20 people will respond to it for every like you get. So, but here's the last 2 comments from Mark and Aaron, who I have no idea who is. Who are you? You're certainly not the visionary I thought you were. What an incredible disappointment. Looks like the typical religious sellout. So he just called me. It's a nice snap. And then he goes, it proves you can fool most of the people most of the time. Now, I had a friend who called me on the phone and said, so you got to take that off. I said, no. Why? Why? I started monitoring, deciding when to allow what I'm going to allow. So unless it's vulgar or violent or anything like that, what we say. Now you can go and you can see some, that's minor sense. Just let it right there. Just let it stay. And what happens though is that in people's mind though, that increases their respect. Because it shows that you are transparent, you're authentic. You're not in the business of just trying to look good and puff up yourself. You stand before people and we hold these truths in what? Earth of vessels, which means we're all what? A crackpot. And so here it is. So part of this use of social media is also exposing yourself to criticism. I believe in what I got some, you know, anybody on the circuit's got hate sites. If you have any kind of hate sites you got, Rick Warren has, I mean, all that. But I'm not too far behind. But I'll even, if there's a new addition to a hate site, I'll even post it on my Facebook. This is the newest thing they're saying about social media. Now, the only problem with that is that increases the traffic. That then when people Google you, then that means it goes higher at the search engine. But if you don't feel, let me also show you how you can also use Google. We'll end here. But just go to the Google search bar, okay? If you want to point out, we are living in a post-Christian, increasingly anti-Christian culture. This is a mission field. All right? And the church has no idea how it appears to the world. We still think we have the home court advantage. They're all away games. And the crowds are not cheering for us away. Now, you can say that, or you can say that and say this, but you don't believe me. Put up there. Why? Are Christians. So. Okay, first three are. We have a huge crusade. You're loving up there. But. Arrogant, nice, judgmental. Let's do A. By a Christian celibate. Let's just do A. By a Christian celibate. Arrogant, awesome, angry. B. Broke, bigoted, bored, and grateful. C. Close-minded, crazy, creepy, cruel. D. Perhaps divided about homosexuality, offensive. E. Easily offended, evil, extreme, against evolution. F. This is how our culture thinks of us. Just go through the other. G. See a difference. Why are Jews so? So just see it. So we're not in this all by ourselves. But you can't fool Google. So you can use this. Churches need to be taught some rules. And by the way, I'm going to be narrow for the rules. There is such thing as a golden rule. Golden rule is what? When others, as you have been doing. Now, most of our people hear that stuff. But it is a there's not one business out there living by the golden rule. And there's not one. Now, it is an improvement over the silver rule. The silver rule is do to others. No, that's the iron rule. So every man is playing these images. But this, the silver rule, going to others' ads, helps with eye for eye, tooth for tooth. A lot of people still live by that. So that's the state of the Middle East. The golden rule, going to others as they have done unto you. Who does that put at the center of the universe? You. Well, if it's good enough for me, it's good enough for you. And we have a lot of church people that are still thinking that the golden rule is what Jesus wants us to live by. When none of them goes to any store, any restaurant who's living by the golden rule, it's always have it. It's the platinum rule. And they actually have in their wallets a card that trumps a gold card. It's called a platinum card. And the platinum rule is do unto others as they would have you do unto them. But our churches are stuck in this golden rule mentality, in a platinum rule culture, with what I call a titanium rule. Because Jesus came. Jesus said in his farewell discourse, I want you to do others. I want you to love others. How? This is his last commandment. I give you a new commandment. I give you a new rule. Here's my new rule. Here's my new commandment. Love up one another. Doing to others is we would have them doing us if it's us. If this music is good enough for me, it brought me to Jesus, good enough for you. If this worship is good enough for me, see, that's a big, that's what they're thinking. Because we've been taught, they've been taught to think the golden rule's good. We got golden rule churches and a platinum rule culture with a titanium rule Jesus. And the Jesus rule is doing to one another as I have done to you. And how do you know? And then he defines it. Greater love has no limits. You love one another as I love you. What does that mean? Greater love has no limits and you're willing to. To test it. So what are you willing to make? You know you're living the Jesus rule. If you're willing to lay down my whole life. My last. That's three kids. First one's a deal with Martin. The last three was vegetarian. I hate this. I mean, by the way, this is not good music. And it keeps on to hear one. It's a small one after all. I'm not going to say it because it will stay with me. So, VeggieTales do to me, we're figuring out the people why. I mean, I actually got stickers I put on my shoes. You know what I want to do when I say, Mr. Tomato? I'm going to slump that sucker fat. Larry Cucumber. You know what I want to do, Larry Cucumber? Okay. And every time a VeggieTales video came out of my life, I want to get out of the VeggieTales. And I turned my whole household into a salad bowl. I laid down my $20. Why? Because I wanted them to pick up. And Eric made a letter to Jesus. So we've got to teach our people, all generations, it's time to live the Jesus way. It's time to live the pecking. And that is, how do you know you're doing well reaching those 22nd century kids for Jesus? Do you like? If you like it, who's it for? You. If your church is not paying.